Okay, so I'm going to talk about bias and fairness in artificial and human intelligence and how it affects every one of us daily, like 1,000 times. And in the last years, those headlines showed up in different papers, all of the newspapers, all of the world, showing that Amazon's Grab secret AI recruiting tool that showed bias against women, or the weak in tech algorithm. Algorithmic bias is bad, uncovering is good. So I want to explore in this talk today how this happens, because AI, yeah, it affects all of us. And actually, we think AI or algorithms, it's mathematics. Mathematics are numbers. They should be correct. So, and we believe it's true. It should be right. So how do things like these happen? So first, quick explanation of the terms I'm going to use in this talk. So artificial intelligence, AI, is the use of computer programs that have some of the qualities of the human mind, such as the ability to understand language, recognize pictures, and learn from experience. And this learn from experience is basically we feed an algorithm data and a definition of success. So an AI needs data where it makes its connections from, and it needs a definition of success to know, okay, this is a good learning, this is a bad learning. Then bias is the fact of allowing personal opinions to influence your judgment in an unfair way, according to the Cambridge Dictionary. But there is also a clear mathematical definition of bias. It's a difference between the estimator's expected value and the true value. And we can clearly define bias and measure bias, which is good. Because fairness is the quality of treating people equally or in a way that is right or reasonable. And there is no single mathematical definition of fairness. Like, there are 21 that I found mathematically, but they all are different, and maybe they also, you cannot fulfill all of them at the same time, because this right or reasonable, this really depends on the context and also on the personal opinion of people. For example, if we have mortgage applications for a loan and we have like 100 people, 20 of them are women and 80 of them are men. If 50% of all men get approved for a mortgage, is it fair if also 50% of all women get one? But what if there would be more credible women? Is it then fair or unfair? So this really depends on the personal view of fairness. So it is really hard to measure fairness in an algorithm, because we cannot define it. And an example of one of the headlines was with Amazon. Amazon had a tool, an AI, for CV screening. So if you applied for a job at Amazon, an AI looked at your CV and then decided if you get into the next round, because they get so many applications every year. The problem is that after some time, they found out that this AI is not treating applications in a gender-neutral way. So, and this happened because the algorithm used all CVs of the people working at Amazon in the last 10 years. They were fed to the AI to learn what is good, what is bad. And you can imagine in like software developing jobs, there are not many women. So the women were underrepresented in this a huge number of CVs the AI got, and then somehow the AI learned, okay, being a woman is bad or not good for being also a software developer, so women were just filtered out. And this was not the intention of the people there. They wanted women to hire, but they just didn't think that the AI could make this connection. So it's often, or almost every time, it's the underlying data rather than the AI itself that are the problem. It's not the AI. The AI is not mean or anything. It just learns what we give it. And this is also what, in my first semester here at ETH, in Introduction to Programming, our professor said. The good thing about programming is The computer always does what you tell him to do. And the bad thing about programming is the computer always does what you say. So the bias has been introduced into AI by humans. The AI just learns, and with the tools we give it to learn. So it's not mean or anything, actually. But we humans have to think about what data we give the AI to make that it can make connections and learn. And first of all, for that, to know what data we can give the AI, we have to figure out the different sources of bias. And I found this chart of bias, which is very, this is like getting more into a bit into AI, but I just assume that you now got a bit how AI works. So there are two main areas where bias can occur in AI. First is data, and the second is the model itself, so the algorithm. And in the data generation, there are three types of bias: historical bias, representation bias, and measurement bias. And historical bias is really just if there's a misalignment between the world as it is and the values we have in our data. So in our Amazon CV example, it's just the amount of all old CVs was just biased. Representation bias is really when one population is underrepresented, which is again in our CV, it's just the amount of women in the data set of the AI was underrepresented. Then the measurement bias is really arises when choosing features and labels you use to train the AI. So coming back again to the Amazon example, this wasn't the case, but like I've tried to find an example how it would be. So if you maybe look at all your current employees and they get maybe a grade or something like a performance each year, then maybe if someone worked at Alexa and Alexa was a huge success, so maybe one developer at Alexa got a better performance or grade for the whole his work all year than just any other guy who also did a great job, because this was just biased by the people who gave this grade or performance to this software developer. And then the other types of bias occur during the model building and the implementation and evaluation. So the aggregation bias is really when just populations are inappropriately combined. So maybe a single model is not good for all populations. So an example would have been maybe it would have been better to train like one model on female CVs and one model on male CVs, or just maybe also just remove the sex from every CV or something in this direction. Evaluation bias would arise from the performance metric that is used in the AI that is maybe not appropriate for this type of model and data injected. So maybe it's not accuracy, but another score that should be optimized in this AI. And deployment bias, the last one, is really just when the system is used or interpreted in an inappropriate way. So, for example, here also comes then again the human interpretation and the human bias. So maybe I, as a human, I just don't look at CVs with a criminal of people with a criminal record, which is then again biased, and my personal bias too. So now we actually know all these sources of bias. So actually, we can just target all of them, and then we could create fair AI. But in the real world, it's different. Because there is a trade-off between accuracy and fairness. And accuracy, now I just really mean in like the performance of the AI. Because maybe it was not, like in the AI's point of view, it was good to filter out all women because they found many perfect candidates for software development jobs in just the men, because the accuracy of the AI was low, was high then, sorry. So the problem is The more accurate the model, the higher the profits of AI companies. They want to sell their software, and they want to sell accurate software. So the problem here with this trade-off between accuracy and fairness, and that AI companies are, they want to make profits. The firms are not really, naturally or economically, not incentivized to ensure fair algorithms. And this is like the biggest problem here. Because they don't have a reason, because also this fairness issue is not very, very popular nowadays, although it happens a lot. But it's getting, with all these headlines I showed you before, it's getting more popular and more people care about it. So we also, on the other hand, have that unfair AI is bad for the brand reputation for your company. And also, you need customers that trust your system. If I don't buy an AI software from a company, if I think it's unfair and it doesn't like treat everyone the same way. So this is also is like the other side of this problem. And also in real life, what you do then when you know, okay, my fairness is maybe. My AI is maybe unfair, or to check if my AI is fair, what should I do? And in real life, you hire consultants. So I found this chart from McKinsey, but I think it's really applicable. So that's why I show it and don't show like the fairness guidelines from Google, because I really think this is something that you can apply if you are a CEO at some company and buy an AI program from another company. So the message is translate company values into AI development, because the company values from all companies are, I want to make the world a better place and so on. And then dig deep by asking analytics teams questions in key areas. So those key areas are really also targeting the sources of bias I showed you before. The first two is really about the data set itself. How is the data acquired? Is it just the simple solution, take all the old CVs? And also, is it suitable? Is every population represented? Did we forget something? And this is like a time-consuming and part, and it's also expensive to collect more data. But however, if your data is not biased, this helps a lot, as we saw in the sources of bias before. And also, if you have better data, your accuracy also will get better. So this is kind of a good thing about collecting more data and also more qualitative data. And the third point is AI output fairness. So is fairness considered at every point in the development process, and also in the model building, monitoring, and also afterwards? So maybe if you know my AI could be unfair, you can also check after the predictions. You can just apply some fairness constraints and check if your predictions are fair. The fourth point, regulatory compliance and engagement, is really also on the corporate level to think about other teams. Do we maybe need the data scientists also, do they need to work with the legal teams or with regulatory people? So work together on all these issues in the whole company and don't just leave it to the data analytics and developers to think about fairness. And the last one I consider the most important is the AI model explainability. So a CEO or just anyone off the board should be able to explain what the AI in your company product does, because the CEO defines the strategy of the company and its corporate values and so on. So he needs to understand what is going on within his company. And if he just says, oh yeah, I don't know, really the technical stuff, I just leave it to them, this is not gonna work. So he needs to understand the single details and how fairness is checked and applied and what are the reasons for all of this? And this brings me to the next point. So who decides if an AI solution is fair? Like, there are, right now, there is no rule about this. And fairness is a very personal thing. So yeah, who's in charge basically here? And because any debate about bias and fairness should also approach the issues of power hierarchy, who profits from AI, in what ways, whose values are embedded in the systems. So it's important that, first of all, the AI companies understand the fairness issue, and that the CEOs of AI companies understand what's going on and what they sell to other people. Then, is it first of all, it could be the AI companies, but it could also be the client companies. So these are just the biggest companies in the world. So they buy AI solutions from AI companies. So is it their responsibility to ask the AI companies, hey, is your AI fair? Or do maybe, if you buy a solution, do you define the fairness constraints you want to have in your product? And because also the client companies must be able to understand, explain how these decisions are made. And third one, do we need regulations? Because we elect our government. We don't elect CEOs from companies. And we actually we have our government that should like represent us and our views on fairness. So does the government have to like make legal requirements and regulations for AI that it should fulfill, and should the governments like define this minimum amount of fairness each AI should have? This would need a significant structural change and is really important nowadays. And I just think that nobody really talks about it and doesn't care, and it actually should be done today and not tomorrow. And on the positive side, AI could, if it all of this works, AI can reduce human biases, because the process of AI is really fair. We can actually unroll it. We can check every calculation an AI makes, although it's very hard and expensive, but we theoretically could. And unlike human decisions, which are often like just gut instincts or so, we can really figure out how an AI came to this solution. And last point is the algorithms don't have emotions or instincts. So in moments of crisis, AI can follow ethical guidelines much better than humans. For example, in the car example we had last week, if the autonomous car cannot stop, should he drive like over an elderly lady or two children? So a car just would then do what it was programmed to do, and humans would maybe not follow through with the correct ethical decision. So, yeah, there is much more to research on. The numbers of papers on fairness in AI exploded over the last 2 years. And, yeah, that's it. If you have any questions, I'm still here. Thank you for listening.